Good morning again, and welcome to this 8th lecture in adaptive signal processing, which is on recursive least square filter. In the previous lectures, we have seen starting with the Wiener optimal filter. We moved on to see how this optimal filter, if we want to update these weights in a recursive fashion, we could use this steepest descent approach to update these weights. For a more practical use of this weight update, we looked at the least mean square filter, which has a very simple update for these weights, ensuring that with a proper choice of mu, the weights converge and correspondingly the error gets minimized. So, all these approaches assume that we could have an estimate of the statistics of the signal, and based on that we were making our algorithm do something. So, now we will look at an algorithm which does not expect any statistics to be available and still try to do things which we wanted to do, that is in an adaptive fashion try to estimate a signal, right. So, this is referred to as this recursive least square filter, and that is what we will see in this today's lecture, which would also kind of be the last major topic under this adaptive signal processing. As mentioned, so the main motivation to look at RLS or the recursive least square filter is, in LMS, if you look at, we minimize this mean square error, right. So, minimizing this mean square error, mean here indicates already a statistics. So, this needed knowledge of either the autocorrelation, either to obtain the mu, or some other statistical estimate, either to find a bound on mu or some other aspects in terms of convergence and other things. So, this was one aspect, and this is also the same thing in the Wiener filter and as well as this steepest descent based adaptive filter, right. So, another aspect which was not very obvious is this convergence, right. So, what do you mean by convergence? In an LMS algorithm, the number of steps it takes to obtain the optimal weight is denoted as this convergence speed, and this usually is certain number of iterations in this LMS. Okay. So, which means if the LMS tries to converge, and by the time it converges, if there is a change in the signal, then the algorithm has to restart and again look at how to get this optimal weight. Okay. So, this is an issue which has to be handled, that how does these algorithms adapt. So, again, this is not necessarily tracking, but this is more like adaptation of the weights. Okay. So, if we want to move away from the statistics, which is what we wanted to minimize here, which is a mean square error, what is an alternate approach? The alternate approach is, rather than looking at the statistics, can we look at the deterministic error, right. So, of course, we know that a simple error function, which is the difference, has issues because it could be positive or negative and there could be other issues with it. And also, we need a function which is kind of having a good differential property, because that it can be differentiated, because that tells us do something better. Okay. So, one such error is which does not use the statistics, but depends on the actual data, right. By depending on actual data, we are in some sense making the system time varying, right. This is one of the requirements for this adaptive filters. So, what is that error function? So, in some sense, it is very close to what we did before. The notation wise, let us say zeta, but then we introduce this term n, and we have on this right a sum of the EFI whole squared, right. So, the note, we have dropped the expectation here, right. In the LMS and the Wiener filter, we had an expectation here or expectation here, which is expectation or the mean of this square error. Instead, what we do here is we just look at the square error and minimize it, right. So, hence the name least square and recursive least square is something which we will see soon why it is recursive, right. But for now, it is just this least square error which we are trying to minimize, and rather than trying to give weightage to all the weights evenly, what we do is we say, okay, so this is an adaptive system, it's hopefully doing something useful as it goes or progresses in time, which means past errors do not count much, right. So, how do we bring that aspect into this error function? So, we bring a weight in factor which is exponentially decreasing, that is the most oldest sample has very less weight, accordingly the weight will be not used, and the most recent sample for n will be given most weight, right. So, with this option we have an error now which is deterministic and hopefully will not depend on any statistics of this to be estimated. It does depend on the statistics of the signal, but we do not have to estimate that statistics as part of this update, right. So, let us see what happens if we define this error function, how does our algorithm get modified to as opposed to what we had in the LMS, right. And this choice of lambda is also important, we will see later what this lambda, what is the role of this lambda. So, we rewrite or we write this error function as by now we are very very familiar with doing this. Any error is assuming I have access to the desired signal can be written in this way, where this is what we expect or estimate our d hat to be, right. So, this is an expectation of our desired signal, and what we assume in this case is this w n, which is the weight at some time n, is held constant during the whole 0 to n, right. So, this 0 meaning that means this weight is supposed to be constant throughout until this point in time, and that is what we are using to estimate this weight, right. So, now let us consider minimizing this error, which is again the standard thing which we have done in the past by looking at the gradient, setting it to 0 and seeing which weight minimizes this error, right. So, we go ahead and do the same thing, find the gradient of this error function with respect to this weight vector, set it to 0, and what we end up is something like this, right. Again, this is not any much different from what we had in the past. So, this is by saying zeta n is, let us say this e n times n conjugate, and then expanding it out for e n, that is what we have here, right. So, if you do this and rewrite this expression, again do this on your own because it is not be that difficult, you just substitute for this e of I in terms of d of I and w transpose x, and you will end up with simplified version as shown here, right. So, this equation here is very similar to what we used to have in the past, which is written here, which is essentially L or P is the order of the filter. So, we have W and L times this term here, which is using x and x I minus L and I minus k with a factor lambda, which is not something we have seen before. And similarly, on the right side, you have the desired signal D multiplied by the input signal. So, if you just take a moment to look at this, if you assume that there is an expectation here, then this expectation is like this will be an Rx term, this will be an Rdx term, right. So, now we do not have an expectation, which essentially indicates that this is a deterministic form of kind of the expressions or equations we had in the past, right. So, you can compare this with the Wiener filter equation which we had derived, they will be almost similar except that there is a lambda here and there is no expectation here, right. So, though it does not have an expectation, just for discussion and to keep it or easily relate this RLS with LMS or the Wiener filter, we will use this notation of R to indicate that this is the data matrix, that is a term we use, and then this is the cross correlation between the data and the input signal, right. So, let us look at this, what is this in terms of the current context, which is the recursive least square filter, right. So, let us relook at this equation and see how we go about doing our estimate for the W, right. So, note that this is same as what we had, just the difference, which is the key difference, that this Rx is obtained just from the data, right. Of course, you could say that this even in the case when we want to actually use an expectation, it was a data dependent expectation. But here there is no such explicit use of expectation, we are just using the data as such. So, if you use a pth order filter, then you will have a p plus 1 length Rx or p plus 1 by p plus 1 matrix, which is this term here. This lambda is a choice of lambda we choose, which what is written here, and then the Rdx which we use here is essentially again d of I times x of I with no expectation here. Okay. So, just remember in the RLS discussion, this r and small r are all only notations indicating expectations. They don't really have expectation, they're just data driven terms, right? So while this is fine, this seems like a setup we had in the optimal Wiener filter. Again, we have the same motivation as we had in the earlier case, that we now need a recursive update for WN. Just one WN is not we are interested in. We wanted to start from some WN and see how this moves as we go along, right? So how do we do that? We try to rewrite WN as WN minus 1 plus del, some update to that WN minus 1, right? So what would this mean? This would mean if you look at WN, it's R inverse N and R dx N, right? So we need recursion for R inverse, okay. So not R but R inverse, right, and R dx, right. So this is the recursion we need, and how do we do it? So the recursion for R dx is kind of straightforward. You can just look at this expression here. So R dx of n is this term here. So if you want to find n minus 1, you can accordingly use, you can separate this into two terms, one the n minus 1 and then the other is up to the sum up to that term, right. So that is what is done here. If you rewrite this as R dx n minus 1, you will have lambda times R dx n minus 1 plus this d of n x of n, right. This d of n x of n is lambda with 1, so that is all you have here, which seems like a easy thing to do, right. But the other recursion we want is for an R inverse. If it had been just Rx, we could have used just this expression here and used it. But now we want instead for R inverse of n, not just Rn, right. So let us see how we get this recursion. So this R inverse n is lambda Rx n minus 1, which is just written from here, plus xn times xn times 2. This is very similar to what we have done here, but the key is there is an inversion here, right. So this inversion has to be handled. Of course, you can think about what you have done in linear algebra in the past and see is there a better way or is there a way to update this iteratively, right. If you think a bit or if you have more familiar with linear algebra, this you can see is of a form some matrix A plus some matrix product of matrices. Of course, in this case these matrices happen to be vectors, it is A plus B, C, D, the whole inverse, right. So there is a neat lemma which is called as a matrix inversion lemma, which we would use, right. So what is that matrix inversion lemma? It is just shown here for your convenience. It is A plus B, C, D if it is the inverse. This can be expanded and written it in this form, okay. So this is also called as Woodbury's identity. So in any case, if you use this expansion for this inverse of the matrix, this looks a little complicated, but it's kind of you can prove this that this is true. Probably you can do this as a homework, but this is what we want to use, right? So we substitute for A as lambda Rx, B, C, D are basically Xn and Xn transpose, right? We don't have a C matrix, it's just an identity matrix. If you rewrite it or write it in using this identity, so you'll have this term which is lambda inverse Rx inverse minus this lambda comes up Rx inverse n minus 1. These are these B and D matrices. This is essentially our A inverse term here, right? A inverse term here and A inverse term here is essentially lambda inverse Rx inverse, which gets combined, and you have Rx inverse here and Rx inverse here. The denominator is essentially this C inverse plus D inverse. C for us is identity, is just 1. D is again this Xn and A inverse is this A inverse. So that is what we have written here. Again, there is nothing much to say or intuition to this expression, except we have rewritten Xn in a form which we think is can be separated and individual terms can be updated. So again, we now introduce some notations to see this recursion in a more simpler form. One substitution we make is to drop this inverse, we just use this notation of P. So you just have to remember that P is necessarily just this R inverse, right? It's an inverse autocorrelation matrix. And another notation we use is this G. This is again to simplify this term on the right. So we rewrite it in a form by factoring it out and using this P of n in this expression here. So if you do that, what we have is this P of n is essentially this. So because that's this term, this P of n is Rx inverse. So that is lambda inverse times P n minus 1, which is Rx inverse, minus this term g of n, which is what is here, right? Which is a kind of a simplification or some part of this expression on the right, just trying to get out this x n and p n minus 1, so that we could factor out this p n and minus 1 in this expression, right? So after writing this, we can rewrite this and simplify it to say that this g of n is essentially p of n times x of n, right? So it's saying that x of p of n is what, it's just r inverse, so it's r inverse x, right? It's like a gain which is obtained by taking the autocorrelation matrix with this x of n. Of course, this has some meaning, but let's right now not worry about what that means, and let's move on to see how we simplify this further. Right? We are still in the process of obtaining a recursion for r inverse. Right? So coming back to that recursion, so we can re-look at that recursion in this form. Recall Wn is R inverse RDX is what we had. So we had used this change of notation from R inverse, we are using P. So we use this P of n times RDXn. Again, we saw in the previous slide that this P of n can be written in terms of lambda, and RDX can be termed in terms of RDXn minus 1. So we are essentially using that update here. RDX of n is lambda times RDXn minus 1. Plus d of n x of n, right? So that's what is written here. Once you substitute for rdxn, we now move on and substitute for p of n, or the recursion for p of n. So this gets simplified. So just to recall, you can look at the previous slide. If you rewrite this, this term gets written in this form. What we essentially have is this wn minus 1, you can relate to this, is very similar, and it's written as pn minus 1 rdxn minus 1. Using this n minus 1 recursion, we can rewrite Wn as Wn minus 1 plus using the recursion here. You can simplify and rewrite it this form, right? So the only aspect of this recursion is this weight at Wn depends on the weight at n minus 1 plus some gain, right? So this is, let's say notationally we'll say this is a gain, right? What role does this gain play? This gain essentially acts on this so called error term. This alpha is a priori error, okay. So this alpha is an a priori error, which is essentially d of n minus wn minus 1 x of n. The thing to note here is this is called a priori error because it uses the weight from the previous instant, which means it is not updated yet. It is acting on the input signal x of n, and that is the error we have, right? So what do we want? We want this a priori error, which we have without any updates on Wn, to be used in a way that when we update our weight Wn minus 1, we get a new Wn, where this Wn is supposed to minimize our actual error, which is the posterior error, right? So you can think of that this updated Wn will help us minimize what is called as this posterior error, right? So what is this posterior error? Just relate to how we had the prior a priori error. This is essentially the error we actually wanted to minimize, which is d of n minus wn transpose x of n, right? So x is the input signal. So you can see that this seems like a good nice form for this iteration. The weight at some time looks at the prior error without any update, does something to that error so that this update, that error is used to update our previous weight, right? And that's a kind of a very useful way to look at such algorithms, that the adaptation actually depends on the error and some gain, and then gain has to act something in a way which is smart enough that it gives enough weightage to the error, either to use it or not to use it, right? That's what the role of gain is, right? For those of you who are familiar with Kalman gain, you could think of this is like a Kalman gain, this is like an innovation term, okay. If you are not, then it is okay. So this is just as a aside which I want to know. So now that we have seen what this update is, I mean it is worth looking at kind of the algorithm in its whole the steps of this algorithm. So with an RLS algorithm, we assume an order which we are interested in. Lambda is some weighting vector which controls exponential decay in the error which we want. That is, let us say, usually less than 1. So there is some initialization which we have to make, because if you recall, the iteration will depend on P, which is the autocorrelation matrix inverse. Since we said we are not going to use any knowledge about the statistics, we need to some way initialize this algorithm. The simplest way is just assume that to be identity, right. Rather than just taking identity, you use a scaled version of the identity. So this is the inverse. So basically that is what we have, 1 over lambda, right. Of course, you could take much more intelligent RXs, but then that involves some computations and some delay in getting the RX. To avoid all this, we just start with this simple initialization. In practice, this is good enough and works well, and that will give us an initialization for P. Of course, weights also you could initialize to anything meaningful, but just initializing to all zeros is also fine, because we do have a recursion which adds up, right. So with that initialization, which is one of the important aspects of the RLS algorithm, we move on to the actual computation in the RLS algorithm. So by computation, we mean for every n, as in when we get samples, we need to update this weight. Of course, the weight length is fixed, that is length p. The starting point, again, is just a slightly different, this z is a variable introduced to have this understood slightly better, it is just a change of variable. So we will denote this p of n minus 1 times x of n as z of n. If we do it, then g of n, which is what we saw in the previous slide, essentially is z of z over n, z of n divided by this term here, right. And then accordingly, we will have alpha n, which is the a priori error, this is the input desired signal, the input signal, but the previous weight, that is the weight before update. Using this a priori error and the gain g of n, we get the new set of weights w n. Once we get this new set of weights, we get ready also for the next iteration. For that, we again use this g of n and this z n and this p of n minus 1 which we had before, right. So this p of n is essentially to be used in the next iteration. So next iteration, we will get p n minus 1 here, z n will be updated based on this, and then we kind of recursively go through this process, right. So what is not very obvious here is this update ensures that we minimize the least square error, right. So what we have seen is an iterative way to update the least square error, and as was mentioned, the error we are considering is up to the point n. If it starts from some 0 and if you are looking at a time n, this aids ensure that this weights error gets minimized, and at every n there is a set of w which will minimize all the error up to that point, right. So here it is just like computing all these parts is what the RLS algorithm is. So of course, you can see that this algorithm is not as simple as just the inner product computation. It does involve more than inner product computation, certain divisions, additions, and these are all matrices. The key to note is these are matrices. P is a matrix, which is an autocorrelation matrix or inverse of the autocorrelation matrix. Of course, we are not doing an explicit inversion, which we avoided by using the matrix inversion lemma. But still, it has these matrix computations here and here, and so we will see that computationally it is slightly more complicated or demanding than a simple LMS algorithm, right. Nevertheless, it does not use any statistics and does not try to estimate the statistics, it just uses the data directly. In some, in that sense, it is like a data driven algorithm to adaptively update the weights, right. So that is about the actual RLS algorithm. So what remains is we just need to understand how does this algorithm perform. Of course, one can prove convergence of these weights and so on, but I think that is not of that interest. So we will just look at how does this RLS algorithm perform. So one thing to note is recall in LMS, any change needs an iteration in LMS to for the weight to converge. So here there is no iteration to converge, but every n there is more computation, but with that computation this leads to an improved performance, that is we are minimizing the error more kind of faster, right. At every n just update of that matrix is what we need, and then we have a minimum error, right. So in that sense, this is faster than LMS. That is the time to converge, but the computation time may be little more, but that's taken care, right? Because in LMS you need many iterations to converge. Here every iteration is an update and it needs a minimum square. The other aspect is it is less sensitive to the autocorrelation estimates, because we are not actually estimating the autocorrelation matrix, we are just using the data directly to get it, right? So with this, the dependence on eigenvalues or the kind of noisy gradient updates we had in the LMS, such things are avoided. In some sense, this is a deterministic update, and hence we can avoid such things, right? So from performance perspective, while there are not big differences, there are subtle differences between what an LMS does and an RLS does. And like as I said, for many real-time applications, LMS is a good algorithm. But for algorithms where you are interested in understanding the behavior, not necessarily in a real-time sense, then the RLS is a good algorithm to try and use. Right? So the other aspect on this of this algorithm is the computational aspects themselves. So LMS, as we saw before, is just an inner product computation. It just, if there is a length of the filter is p, it's p multiplies. So if I use the order notation, it's just order p, right? That's the dominating computation, that's the inner product. Whereas if you look at the RLS, you could look at the individual steps of the algorithm, and each of them will be kind of, most of them will be of this order p squared, right? They may involve a product of a matrix, and hence we would at least need p squared operation. So if you look at from this point of view, the RLS is computationally more demanding than an LMS, but performance wise it is equally good and better sometimes than the LMS. It does not depend on a mu value, but it does depend on a lambda value, but there does not have to be too much care taken in choosing what lambda is, right? As long as it is less than 1, it will converge. It just how much is the error is something which we have to worry about. So that kind of is what I wanted to talk about in terms of saying what this RLS is. So when we talk about adaptive algorithm, we have seen LMS and RLS. These are kind of the two main algorithms which whenever you talk about adaptive signal processing, you use them. Of course, this RLS has a good extension, and one of the extension is the more popular Kalman filter. So though in the outline we did mention about Kalman filter, given what we have covered, I think we will not further look at Kalman filter. Of course, I would probably give some reference material for Kalman filter along with this RLS as a kind of extension of RLS. So the ideas in RLS are useful in many other signal processing algorithms. So you'll, many times you'll have recursive least square in many forms of it. Again, here we need to look at a simulation to understand how an RLS does as opposed to how LMS does. So these will be form part of the simulation which will be shared along with this course material. Together, by looking at LMS and RLS, we have covered almost all aspects of adaptive signal processing. Though we did a bit of analysis on the LMS filter, we haven't done much analysis on the RLS, because there is, except for the convergent, there is not much to analyze in the RLS filter. So depending on the application, one can choose an LMS and RLS filter to design and achieve the performance you need. So with that discussion, I come to the end of this lecture aspects of this adaptive signal processing course. I intend to give one small video or link where I would mention about the website which could be used along with this course, so that the accompanying homeworks or practice material or the simulations would be updated. So do look for that link, or it may be in the course website of the ARPIT, where I'll provide this link for this additional lecture material. Thanks for listening. Hopefully this set of lectures would have given you a good sense of what adaptive signal processing means. While these are slightly different from the other parts of this course, that is the sensors and circuits, this kind of will be more related to the mathematical aspects of this electronic systems course. So I strongly encourage to relate aspects covered in this adaptive signal processing part to the mathematics involved in electronic systems, because they are very tightly related. Many of the deterministic cases can be looked at from a stochastic sense, which is where the power of this adaptive filters come in, because they are used in real time. They can be time varying. They need not always look at deterministic signals, and most real world signals are random processes or non-deterministic. So thanks for listening, and that ends my lecture on this recursive list filter and also the adaptive signal processing course.